Well, first of all, yeah, thank you, Sharon, for inviting me, and thank you, Nona, for making this possible. Thanks, everybody.
I started with fine arts, interested in video and painting. Then I did an MSc multimedia assistant, which was a technical master. I really needed to get in touch with stories, the real stories, because I came with so much technology. I was always finding the problem was always the content. So we can have very exciting technologies, but if the content doesn't grab our audiences, doesn't express something we care about, if we are not crafting an emotional journey for our audiences, it doesn't matter. The technology we use is not going to work. I often work with story collected from people, so the content was not mine to start with. So again, who owns the stories? And once I take them and I modify them and I alter them, you know, how do you make sure these people still own them, or how good your intentions are, and sort of where you want to be open and you want everybody to hear your stories, everybody to participate. There are issues with business models. How are these experiences or stories going to continue? Who is going to pay for it? But they call themselves Weird View, the whole community, because they like to think of themselves a little bit odd, and actually they have a lot of weird stories there. And I had really a pleasure to talk to them and start to collect the stories. At the same time, the social network behind this community was very interesting to follow as a hypertext, almost.
You are gonna wear your boots tonight.
Yeah. Collecting the stories has been an experience, because we started we did it by word of mouth. It was all sort of going on, and some people were very open. A family had moved from here. Many families had moved from here, so we had to trace where they were. One was in County Leitrim in the middle of Ireland, and they hosted us for a weekend, myself and Joan, just to tell stories. And they were really happy to tell stories. But the moment we took out our recordings and the camera, they stopped. The atmosphere froze. And so we had to put everything away and just have teas and coffees and just take notes, because otherwise, actually the wrap-up of this project was actually to show it back to the community itself. So we had a one-week show in the town hall of the village, and the community was invited. Actually, we also got other visitors, but the community members came, not all of them, but those who could, they came, and they really enjoyed their own portrait. They enjoyed to see themselves seen from us, which was a little bit the testing point for us, because we thought, you know, what are we going to think? We've interpreted their lives. But they loved it, and they spent the rest of the afternoon into the night just remembering and telling stories to each other. So what really I took away from this was the fact that it worked as a catalyst for really reigniting a sense of community. But to collect the stories, it took me 1 year before I could find something that I could use, because the community was sparse. They were not very trusting. I was one of those new ones from the digital hub. The media lab installed itself in the middle of the Liberties and had no contact with the community whatsoever. So, like, who are you? You're not even Irish. When is a folk tale, and when is just a memory? You know, how, almost like a continuum. How do we go from what I live to what I remember to what becomes the folk sort of myths and stuff, and when it's history? And I wanted to avoid the history that was already written. I wanted to avoid everything that I could find in the tour guides or in the books. And in a way, also with Marine, her book is very unusual, because it's her story of her family and then some history of the neighborhood. But I wanted to focus very much on her family and see what connection were still alive, what things were still alive in the community today. Design was very for me very exciting, researching the content, but then scripting and storyboarding together with the community members, the interaction design. this is that is you can play it, you've seen it, the V, and the steps are stories that somehow relate to the one that are around you, but you have to walk. So the steps are suggesting that you move there to see that.
How was back then, like, to do research on that and try to get story from people and explain or convey the concept of attaching stories to places? And how, like, how you see, like, the field evolving since then?
Well, since then, now we don't have to explain locative need. Everybody knows location-based services, so on that part is jumped. Mm-hmm. But at the time, I had to use some metaphors. Like the desktop metaphor, I was using this metaphor of the place as a container of stories, or the physical editing of the story by walking through the streets. This community, they were very rebellious against authority. They didn't want to go to the office to change the name. Even that was an act they didn't want to recognize. So that is another aspect that comes through a funny story, but it's very revealing. Of the Irish and of this community in particular. This community originated from, had a very high percentage of immigrants from Galway in the west of Ireland during the famine. They didn't have work, they didn't have food. So they went to Dublin and settled in this area because they found work with Guinness. It was a very poor area, and so they kind of gathered together there. And in the Liberties, they used to speak Gaelic. And although Dublin is the English sort of headquarters in Ireland, and so that part was coming through from many stories. But to cut it short, I wanted people to look at the church and see the story and imagine this happening inside, the Christian, you know. But people will get the icon and the alert of the story much further away, so they would miss the connection. So the problem with this area is that there are people from many different countries. On top of having its own problems, then the reputation with this TV series really went extremely bad. So nobody wanted to adventure here. They organized workshops to collect the stories where I went, and I worked with them. And again, similar pattern to the Liberties. I found local member who was a writer and had a book, so he wanted to share his story. But at the same time, we had a number of community members who wanted to tell their stories. And so, and we used a method similar to what Patricia was saying. So we had a workshop explaining them what we were looking for, and then they did it at home on their own. And then they came to us if they had a problem with the technology or to deliver the story itself. This is the introduction. This is a kind of more poetic.
You were standing at the bottom of a lake. Long ago, the water here would have reached a depth of 3 meters in what was to become known as the Belmermeer or Belmer Lake. Eventually, the enterprising Dutch drained the lake, an occurrence that happened not infrequently in this part of the country. This was because land, dry land, was more profitable than water. A dike was built around the old lake. The farmers came, worked the land, and paid their rent. But sometimes war, storms, and other disasters had caused the Belmer to flood once more.
The farmers could only stand and watch as the water flooded the land. The Belmer had been turned back into a lake, but they would return as soon as it had been pumped again. Then they would repair their houses, barns and stalls, they would clear the drains and start all over again.
We had a workshop about finding the stories in the barber shops, because the barber is, I don't remember how I came across, maybe that I have not a barber, but hairdresser that I go always to the same one, and we will never meet outside the hairdresser, but we share a lot, and we see each other regularly. And I know that the same happens with the barbers. They call the psychologist of the poor. So I thought, because Porto has this very old, beautiful barbershop, this was an inspirational setting to investigate the relationship of the storyteller to its audience. And it was just a one-day workshop, so students were sent out. We already identified the barbers, those who were willing to talk. And well, we just had, obviously, we came back with more questions than answers. They tell stories about themselves, and they were also very interesting. Some barbers are very old, and I didn't know that, but they have generations of clients. So the fathers, when it's time, they bring their kids, and it's a kind of a ritual, and that country itself was amazing. We were able to catch one client who shared the story with us, who married the lady who was doing his nails. He was going there, and then he fell in love with this, the issue of privacy, stories and privacy. How do we share, why do we share certain stories and with who? Like I said before, I had problems with communities telling me their stories, but sometimes with someone you just feel, I think it must have happened to many of you, it happened to me on the train, especially in Italy, you sit next to someone and then you find out you're talking about your life and share everything and then you never see this person again. And we had some really incredible deep conversations. And that just only happened in that moment, in that place. And these are interesting experiments. Again, they are dealing with technology limitations. Steve Benford, for example, introduced the idea of self-reporting to counteract the inaccuracy of GPS. We redid the same stuff that we did before. So the map, the dots, GPS, local stories, you go around. The stories are linked to specific location of the road. So the narrator is introductory. You have a 20 meters range, and the GPS triggers this introduction to the story. And the narrator then will tell you, go and look for this marker. And the person is compelled to look for the marker. So it takes a lot of the ambient in by looking for this marker. And by the time they find it, they don't have this feeling that they've been missing out on the surrounding, looking at the screen, because they've been looking at the place. And the markers can be placed in very specific locations where they are safe to watch the video, because if it's a street, if it's some problems with the sunlight on the screen and stuff. So we really tune this experience. I would like just to tell you all that we have strong expertise in HCI, human-computer interaction. I'm more of an artist, digital media. My shift from digital media to HCI happened here. I would like to talk briefly about this project, which was very long. It was a one-year project. A lot of artists have experimented with this kind of displays because it has a lot of charm. Also the sound, the noise, the aura of the object is a kind of an obsolete display today, and the airport got rid of it to substitute it with a really awful digital one. But I think interesting and appealing is the fact that it's usually a medium where we are told something to do, so it's very top down. You look at this board and then you do what it is there, whether it's run to the train, to the plane. So it's a very interesting display to hack and to subvert. Luckily, we have an amazing guy, Clinton, who disassembled it bit by bit and reassembled it in our lab. And this is just to show you. So this is how it is. I think it's really beautiful. I'm really in love with this object. It also has the lights there, and it has some of these other possibilities for you. And this is how it looks for the hackers here. How it looks from the back. So I think that probably you will find a lot of ways to mess with that. And so, because it's so big, we initially started to probe how people would use it with the replica. You have this display that you've never been able to control, and now you can. We made the Twitter, Facebook, and text interface, and we thought it would have been simple just to tell people, you can tell your story here, you know, just text, just whatever is easy, because people knew each other. So the meeting is going on, or I'm late, or this person is sick, or sort of things like that. Then we moved it to a bigger and a more common space. This is the entrance of Technopole, the science park, the science building where we are. We chose the place that is in front of the bar where there is the queue of the people going to buy a sandwich. So they would see it, they would have time to interact if they wanted. Again, our researcher was there with the phone if they didn't want to use their own. Finally, got permission to install it at the airport. So although we could subvert the use of the board itself, they didn't let us put us where we wanted. We wanted to have the departure. And they were afraid, it's really control issues, they were afraid that people would get confused. I said, how do you get confused? Are you reading a story? Because now the board is on our institute. And we have a creative writing class who's using the board as one of the assignments. And we also use it for our own sort of agendas to sort of see what's going on. The guests that come for lectures, they love it. They want all the pictures, the picture of the board and their talk. And then every now and then there's still a story coming up. I suspect it's Julian, because he's the writer. I also send something every now and then, and that's a nice surprise. These are my boots that I couldn't wear. And now I wanted just to thank you all for listening, and if there are questions.
I know we've had a lot of discussion and questions throughout, but we can spend a little bit of time. I know lunch is right after.